Hey, what's going on, guys? Real quick. Some time ago, I did a tutorial on one of the best melodic exercises to me, and that had to deal with the modes. So you had to know the modes in order to do this exercise. The problem is, how do you implement this exercise into your playing? So I'm going to go over the exercise, and then I'm going to show you how you can implement that into your playing. Let's go. Okay, so I want to get straight to the point, but first and foremost, if you don't know your modes, if you're not familiar with them, please go check out the other mode tutorials, and it shows you, it's going to break down every single mode, how they relate to each other, everything you need to know about them. So go check that out first before you come and try to do this exercise or understand how you can implement that in your playing. So let's go. Exercise was in C major. I was going to do the modes in C major. So you had your C major mode, all right, which is your Ionian, your Dorian. All right, I don't want to go over the whole entire thing. All right, so if you know your modes, you know exactly what I'm talking about. But what we did with that exercise is I took the arpeggio of each mode. So the Ionian arpeggio, which is a major 7 arpeggio, the Dorian arpeggio, which is a minor 7 arpeggio on the D, and then a minor arpeggio on the Phrygian, major 7 on the Lydian, dominant arpeggio or flat 7 on the 5 or the Mixolydian. All right, Aeolian is a minor arpeggio, minor 7 flat 5, or the 7th arpeggio, which is the Locrian. All right, just real quick, I know I'm going pretty fast, but follow with me. So the reason why I call this melodic is because most times when you take the chord tones of each scale, the 1, 3, 5, and the 7, that creates a chord, that creates that harmony, all right? So it just becomes melodic or melodious, right? So this particular exercise is just taking the arpeggio of each scale, all right? But to make it interesting, what I did was I ascended the first arpeggio and then descended the next one. I'm going to alternate that way all the way up until I'm to the end. Okay, so ascend the first arpeggio, descend the next arpeggio, ascend, right? So we're going to keep going. What did I leave off? I ascended, right? Oh, okay. So that makes it a little bit more interesting. It doesn't make it so robotic, right? So how are we going to apply this? That's the main question. We've done the exercise. We got it down packed. It's a great dexterity exercise. You're using every single finger. You're stretching your hands out. Always like to do exercises starting from the lower register of the fretboard to the higher register of the fretboard because the frets get narrower. So your fingers are going to have to conform to the fret. So it's already a great exercise by itself. How are we going to apply this? All right. So what I like to do is I just like to take certain sections. I don't like to take it as a whole because it becomes too overwhelming. All right. So how am I going to fit this in? Like a groove or bass line or a song or something like that. And it was funny, the other day I was actually playing in C and I was just kind of creating a groove and I kind of did it by mistake. And if I can remember the groove, you guys go with me on this. So here we go. 1, 2, 3, 4. Anyway, but that was the bass line, all right? Very simple bass line. I was just kind of created it off the top of my head, but it's very diatonic. I'm not using any other notes outside of that major scale. All right, so it starts on the 3, all right? Starts on the 3, 4, which is F or of C, C major. You have to think about it that way. Think about the scale degrees. G, which is the 5 of C major. 6, which is the 6, or A, which is the 6 of C major. And I did something. I'm doing a 3, 3, 2, 1. All right, so it's very diatonic. I'm not going outside of it. That's what I mean by diatonic, by the way. Very simple bass line, and I can actually implement some of those arpeggios. So just like that, you can implement these arpeggios or even the exercise that we just talked about inside that bass line or inside of that groove, right? So what I did was I played the descending D minor, which is a Dorian, right? And then I went up. Descending D minor and then ascending E minor arpeggio, E minor 7 arpeggio. All right, so D minor 7 descending, ascending E minor 7. And I think that was it. All right. So I have no idea why I started there. I just chose to start there, but it works. I played a D minor 7 arpeggio on top of a C major groove, right? Gives it a different sound. So you're not just starting on the root note. So sometimes, most times, I don't really like to start on the root note with a lick or with a fill. And that's the kind of way that you can implement these arpeggios inside of your playing too. Or even if you just want to create a bass line along the arpeggios or along the exercise, that's fine too. But you know what you can use. If you're in a key of C or key of C major, you can use these arpeggios to your benefit. You can even, you know, just kind of move them around, play around with them. I can play some other arpeggios too, see how they sound. I just played the G7 arpeggio, dominant arpeggio, and then Aeolian, which is the A minor 7 arpeggio. And if I'm going too fast, if you guys have any questions, please comment below so I can answer your questions. Usually I'm just responding to you guys if you have a question on something specific so I can help you out further. I know this can be a little overwhelming, but that's what I'm here for. I want you guys to ask your questions, pick my brain. If I need to slow down, let me slow down. But if you understand what I'm going or understand what I'm talking about, let's keep going. So I implemented the G7 and the A minor 7 arpeggio just together. You don't have to do two arpeggios together. I mean, it doesn't matter. You can do one. Just stick with that. D major. Just get creative with it. It's not rocket science. If you can fit it in there, you know the notes that you have to play. You don't even need to know the actual notes themselves. If you know the pattern, if you know the shape of them, you can go with that. You know, whole step, half step. If you know the modes and if you're comfortable with the modes, playing them back and forth and up and down in every key, you should have no problem creating riffs, creating lines, creating. I think I talked about a couple weeks ago. I talked about some of the Jaco lines that he would do. He would play in like a Mixolydian type of a mode. So with the flat seven, that's your modes. That's knowing your modes, being comfortable with your modes, all right? So if you learn your modes and you get comfortable with them, you should be comfortable with your everyday playing, and you shouldn't have a problem playing in any key at all. Just find the relationship. Find the relationship. I think that's the thing that clicks with everybody. It's just finding that relationship between what this exercise is and how to fit it in your playing, because, you know, most likely everybody just wants to fit it in. They want to be able to know what to play, when to play it, and how to play it. But anyway, that was just a quick lesson. I didn't want it to be too long. I want to go over the minor side of things. So stay tuned for that. That'll probably be the next week after this, the next tutorial, but the minor side of the modes. So how to figure out how to do this in a minor key. So we'll talk about that a little later on. Make sure your notes are coming out clean, clear, and precise. And until next time, see ya.